Hi, and thank you for joining us for reInvent this year. The platform may have changed, but the ability to showcase our customers' innovations remains the same. My name is Liz Dennett. I'm a geologist and the lead solution architect for the OSDU Energy Data Platform. If you're wondering what OSDU is or how we're reinventing energy data, well, great news, you've come to the right place. I'm joined here today with Johan Krebbers, the VP of IT Innovation and the General Manager of Emerging Digital Technologies at Shell. It's truly my privilege to introduce Johan, who is accountable for defining and driving the future IT strategy for Shell and spotting new digital technologies. As part of these roles, Johan maintains an active link with external parties like AWS and with startups. Johan is based in Amsterdam, and before this role, he's been in various IT roles with Shell through multiple locations. Most recently, he served as the VP of Architecture for Shell, where he created and developed the global architecture practice across Shell. Now, today we're going to walk through the journey for where OSDU began and where it's headed. We'll begin with looking back at what spurred the need for an energy data platform. From there, we're going to walk through the current status and evolution of the OSDU energy data platform. Then finally, we're going to look ahead and see how this data platform is really putting data at the center of the energy transition. Johan, thank you for joining me today. Let's go ahead and dive into how OSDU is breaking down data silos and fueling innovation.
Many thanks, Liz, for the agenda. So let's now talk about really what this is all about. If you look at the whole subsurface industry, we're going to come out of a world where all the data is stored in many silos out there. We got the data clearly integrated with your applications. And it really makes it very hard to do innovation, to really make changes, to really be ready for the digital age, to really support an AI type environment. So to move from a physics world to a data physics world. So these are some of the challenges we have in a subsurface space. And therefore, we had to do something. And here on this the predictor slide, you see really what it's all about. Yeah? You see, if you look at subsurface, you look at exploration, the different elements, they all have their own data silos. Yeah, that means that the workflows are very narrow because you only work within those data silos. So if you want to look at from exploration all the way to well and how you got there, if you want to look back again, the lineage from well back into your exploration environment is very, very hard to do nowadays. So what we try to do there is really to say, hey, we really need to put data at the center. Yeah, because it's all about data, data, and data again. So we have to put data at the center here. And as we see on the right of the slide, we're really talking about your data platform. So all the data we're talking about, so the data in your exploration environment, in your development environment, in your wells environment, sits together in a single data platform. And as we see at the bottom, the green part at the bottom, your single data platform, all the data bring together, both your structured data and your unstructured data. So all types of data come together into the single data platform. That single data platform is being accessed via an API layer. And that API layer is very much separating the applications from your data. So your application at the top in the dark green part are all your applications. Applications covering that whole spectrum of exploration, development, and wells. And if you look from an OSDU point of view, then really we're talking about the light green part. The light green part is where we work together. We're creating one standard where nobody competes on how you store your data. You compete on what data you have and how you make use of that data. And therefore, the light green part where you see the data ingestion services, because especially in this world, data ingestion is very, very important. So you look then at things like metadata extraction, the data quality before you load that data into your OSDU. And OSDU is a system of record. It really is the master of your data. So it's not a data warehouse, not a data lake, it's a system of record where you really store the data. And that means that you don't store it anywhere else. It's not a copy of some data, it's really where the raw master data is going. You also information security. We also have to make sure that whoever owns this OSDU implementation can determine who has actually access to that environment. Yeah, who has access from the same company or from another company. Also, use of authorization. If you have access, what type of access do you have? Because you want to make sure that the right people have access to the right type of data. So the OSU, the OSU is really that light green part, is the data platform and our supporting services. OSU, in first instance, has been really developed for cloud-based environment, because we need the power of the cloud, in this case, the case of the power of Amazon, to really drive home the benefit of an OSU environment. So that gives you the context of OSU. So really focus at the light green part, what OSU is all about, and then the applications where we compete, where we differentiate, is really, and we really want to make sure that those applications coming from many different companies out there, they really create an ecosystem of people who develop applications. Because the bigger your ecosystem is, the more innovation going to happen in that space. Yeah. And of course, it's also of interest now for those application providers to develop applications, because everybody who's running an OSU type environment will have that same API layer. So you have to develop an application once, but can then be used by many people out there who are running the OSU data platform for this particular space of that business. So if you look at it in more detail, so we really go back to the OSU. Here you see on the right, let me maybe stop at the bottom, the supporting services. And you see that it makes well use of a broad range of Amazon services. I won't go through all the Amazon services, but of course, you see the storage service like there. You see the S3, you see the search out there, and a whole raft of other Amazon services, on top of which we're using OSDU. The OSDU, you see the data platform service, that's where all the data goes. On the left, you see the data ingestion services, that's where you load the data coming in. And because in this space, you know that the amount of data in subsurface space is enormous. In any oil and gas company or any energy company, you really find that most of the data is coming from the subsurface space. And also very diverse type of data. Yeah, there's not one or two data types, but many different data types out there. Then the infrastructure platform services, that is really the cloud platform out there, if made security. And then look at the dark green part of the applications. But also important in the application piece is the workflow orchestration services. Yeah, that's really where, because the new type of applications we talk about nowadays are all Kubernetes driven. Yeah, are really driven by microservices and are orchestrated by Kubernetes. So that orchestration layer is very important to start building your new workflows and make this workflow far more dynamic than they are today. So the workflows do now consist of a whole list of microservices, all the type of services to create that dynamic workflow, which might be different for the type of field you have. Then on the left, you also see in country, because we also have parts in the world where we have no cloud services. Yeah? And therefore, we need to also think, what would be an in-country solution look like? And therefore, we also make, in that case, use of the Amazon in-cloud facility, of in-country facilities, to really also deploy, being able to deploy OSDU in those type of environments. So this is the overall picture. So it's cloud first. We really focus on the cloud environment. But when needed, we also have an in-country type of solution. And remember where OSDU plays. So OSDU plays where you store the data and really how you protect the data and all the services around it. There's also all the operational services around that part of OSDU. Yeah? It's not just the code, but also your backup restore, your monitoring, your logging, your other type of service in this particular space. So this is the overall scope we're looking at. If you then look at it's all about data, we said. So it's really, in the case of OSU, we put data at the heart of everything. Yeah, the focus is data. And if you then think about what can support that story, of course, I already mentioned microservices. We really want to develop now applications based on microservices. So we move away from the legacy type of applications in this space, which often are still PC-based, to applications which are HTML5-based. The UI is HTML5, and underneath, microservices. Yeah. So to get a very flexible orchestration of your workflow. As I mentioned, you might have a business workflow consisting of many different microservices that together gives you a flexible workflow. We'll support both the new type of applications, the microservice type of applications, but also your legacy applications. Your legacy applications, as I mentioned, often are still PC-based, so we also will support PC-based applications. These applications will not have direct full access to the cloud, to the O2 data platform, but we can exchange data between those legacy applications and the data platform itself. Kubernetes, as I mentioned, we have microservices. We've got container-based facilities, and the microservices are really Kubernetes-driven, so it's really the orchestration, part of that orchestration of your microservices. If you talk about subsurface space, it's really all about 3D. Yeah, it's the visualization piece is ultimate, very, very important. And therefore, the 2D and 3D facilities, especially the 3D facilities, are very relevant. And of course, we try to make use of the latest developments. So virtual reality, augmented reality is an important component of that. That whole 3D element, the visualization, and having access to all the data. So in this case, visualization, you don't have access to one slice of the data or also one discipline. No, in the case of the O2 data platform, you have access to all the data in exploration, development, and wells. And having access to all the data also enables now AI capabilities. Because if you have the data sitting in slices like you had before, it's very hard to do an AI across multidisciplines. Because AI is all about data. Machine learning is all about data. So you want to have broad access to data and also access to a large amount of data, historical data. You want all there. And in the case of O2 being a system of record, all the data actually is there. And when we talk about a data-driven environment, you're really moving to a world, because we come out of a world, if you look at the subsurface space, where everything was physics-driven. We now move to a world where your solutions are physics and data-driven. And the data-driven piece is developing and is developing very, very fast. And therefore, that whole access to data, to a data platform, is very, very relevant to even make it possible that you have your AI enabled over there. So it's all about data. And data is the centerpiece. Therefore, when we started OG, we said we're putting data at the center. And everything else is subservient to that. Your applications, your services, your other capabilities are really driven by the data story. And data will be data sitting inside your OG environment, because OG is a system of record, but you also will still have access to maybe external data sources, weather data, other type of data sources. But within OG, we'll show them as one integrated data set. Because we also have facilities in OSDU, we can connect to external data sources and show them as one integrated set of data to that OSDU user out there. So it's that one picture. When we talk about OSDU, we need to remember it's something that's not done by one company. It's really driven out of the open group. So when we started OSDU about 2 years ago, in September 2018, we created an open group forum. Why did we go for the open group? Because we had to work together with many other companies out there. If you want to work together with many other companies, you need a framework, a legal framework. How can you work together? What is the tooling? How can you freely exchange information? So we started with 10 members in September 2018. And now in November 2020, we have over 170 members out there. On the top, you see on the right, many operators, but also lots of companies, startup companies, universities, large companies, small companies, companies from anywhere in the world, from Russia, from the US, from Europe, from Australia, from Africa, from Asia, you name it, and they represent it. So it's really a global initiative. It's really globally driven. And what's so important about a community, they drive the content of OSDU. Yeah? OSDU is really driven by this community out there, and they determine what are the priorities out there. We issued the first release of OSDU just before Christmas last year, in 2019. That was really meant for getting experience with data loading. We issued release 2 in May of this year, really for application development, and release 3, which is the first production release, will come to the market from a development point of view, as we speak today, and from a production point of view, it will come to the market late Q1 2021. There's a full production release. Yeah, there's a full production code. It will be also, and all the services around it. So your data loading services, Connect to external data sources, connect to reporting tooling. So it's not just the code, it's a full gamma of operation services to go around it. We also made, with the start of R3 coming out in March next year, it also is fully open source, so that the OSDU data platform is an open source initiative. That's very important, because that means that everybody has access now, has no input, and can really propose changes and develop changes to the platform. So it's the speed of development of the OSDU data platform will really be driven by the members, and by the initiatives of people developing new environments out there. So it's open source based, based on the Apache license 2.0. It is, of course, it's really a cloud-based environment, but we do support, also mentioned, the on-premise environment is open source. And of course, there will be elements of the data platform which are driven by the particular cloud provider, because we are available on multiple cloud providers, including, of course, Amazon. But there will be also Amazon Pacific elements there, like S3 is Amazon Pacific. Yeah. And of course, on top of that, also we have many ISV companies developing the applications. Yeah, we talked about microservices. Application is separated from the data using the API layer. The data standards, so the data definitions, are managed by the members, by the OSDU forum. So the OSDU forum is the only body who drives the data standards. There's not one company who really drives or can say these are the data standards. No, it's really driven by the OSDU forum. And of course, then the companies can develop their applications against an API, which is also owned by the OSDU forum, and then the data standards owned by the OSDU forum. So we offer an equal playing field for all companies out there. If you're small startup companies, it's the first time in history that you have free access to data in this particular space. In the past, you never had that, because it always was monetized by some larger companies out there. Also, we offer for people who develop applications out there to use the marketplace. There's an Amazon marketplace out there, and we really, if you go to the OSDU forum marketing site, you can load your applications, or you can make your applications knowledgeable via catalog. People can look into that catalog, can look for your applications, say, I want to use this application, Amazon, and from there automatically go to the Amazon marketplace to really then select the application and load the application in your OSDU environment. So really try to do different ways of working to make it easier for companies, software development companies, to make use of these facilities out there.
Now, when we talk about the OSDU on AWS data platform, there's a few key reasons our customers are telling us that they've partnered with AWS for their OSDU solutions. The first reason is security. Security may be on the bottom of this slide, but that's because it represents the foundational and most important thing we do. With OSDU on AWS, our customers get the security of the only commercial cloud that has had its service offerings and associated supply chain vetted and accepted as secure enough for top secret workload. We are committed to working together with our customers and partners to ensure that their OSDU on AWS environments meet or exceeds their security objectives. The second big reason is reliability. Having always available infrastructure is critical. If, for example, you're a geologist and you're trying to extract a variance from a seismic cube that has to run overnight, if that attribute extraction crashes, you could potentially delay maturing your prospect and making a drill, no drill decision. I've actually been there. AWS's extensive and reliable global cloud infrastructure delivers 7 times fewer downtime hours than the next largest cloud provider. The other big driver here is flexibility. And by that, I mean the ability to liberate your data and create workflows that work for whatever your unique needs are. AWS has the largest global community of customers and partners. This ensures that you have full plug-and-play interoperability from any number of best-in-breed applications. Your workflows can be as unique as you are. Now, the common theme with all of this is the Amazon culture of innovation. Everything we do at AWS is built upon democratizing innovation and working backwards to solve complex problems. Just like AWS and Shell initially partnered for the subsurface data universe, and it's just how the OSDU data platform is enabling industry-wide paradigm shifts in data access.
So as I mentioned, OSIO was, when we started OSIO 2 years ago, we very much focused at the exploration, development and well space. But we have a clear vision to make OSIO an energy, an open energy data platform. That means it will include production and will also include other energy sources. So our vision is to make an energy data platform where we bring all the energy related data into a single data platform. So whether we got data from a gas environment, or you get data from a wind farm, solar farm, hydrogen, you'll bring that data into a single data platform. So OSIO, we're really creating out of that now an energy data platform. And that means that we also will bring together the world of hydrocarbons and the world of electrons into a single data platform, into a single environment. How does it look like? Here the white part is really your OSIO data platform. And when we start talking from the left, you see OSIO R3 covers is really what we launch in end of Q1 next year. So by the end of Q1 next year, we'll have a production version of OSIO R3, so release 3, which includes the exploration, development, and well space. Yeah. That will come to the market in production by the end of Q1, by March next year, on multiple cloud platforms. Of course, prime one also is Amazon out there. So that comes for the market. Then we already kicked off projects to include that also upstream production. So the moment we're adding upstream production means we can offer an integrated upstream business, because we then have all the data from exploration all the way to production into a single data platform. Drilling, we kicked off a last project for the early, it's about 9 months ago, to also fully integrate the drilling activities into OSIO. So the data you collect on a drilling platform will get a tight integration with the OSIO data platform to make sure that all the data from your drilling environment ends up in OSIO and can then be used, for instance, again, by AI and other applications out there. So that will come to the market in the second half of next year. By that time, that means we have in principle cover the whole oil and gas business out there. But we're also adding, and those projects also have started already, are other energy sources. And we call it here OSIO R3++. So we kicked off projects to cover the wind farms, solar farms. We kicked off projects to cover CCUS, hydrogen, geothermal. So that whole space of other energy sources, it has been kicked off with real projects, and all driven by the members. Remember how this all works all the time. When we kick off a project, we bring it to all the members of the OSIO forum. They can decide which project they want to join and start driving the project moving forward to real content. We do this for production. We do it for CCUS. You see, you got a very diverse community out there. With CCUS, of course, you will have often a very different interest group than maybe you have with upstream production. But all those we bring all those interests together in our OSIO environment. And there we could talk about an open energy data platform. It's open source. Remember, it was open source, it's still open source, and real time, you see on the right over here. Why do we such a focus real time? Because of the real need for the new energy sources to have solid, high throughput, real time support. So we're really enabling also the OSIO data platform with a full Kafka engine, so we can stream the data, data ingestion, and store the data, also real time data, into an OSIO environment. And then you see API, the common API layer on top of all this data, and on top of the various applications. Yeah. And that's good. The applications, of course, now cover a much broader field, because the data we store is a much broader field as well. So that's our target. This is really what the vision we're working for 2021 and the first half of 2022. We also want to add to that the energy data, of the engineering data. We're not going to store engineering data inside the OSIO data platform. We want to make sure that an OSIO user has transparent access to all engineering data. So your 3D models, so your piping, your instrumentation, etc. So that data will be available, seamless available. And then the world digital twin on top. We want to bring that data together into a single view, because the digital twin is all about bringing together the various data sources, both operational data sources and engineering data sources, into that single view. So those activities for later next year and in 2022. So it's all about with OSDU. Yeah, remember, OSDU is all about API driven. Yeah, it's the first we put data at the center. Remember, data at the center, and the data is accessed via an API layer, and so we create a platform out there for people to develop applications on top of. Yeah, and that API layer is very important. Again, all owned by the OSDU Forum, not by one company, so you have influence on it. Yeah, it's open source based. That means you can, as a company, as any member, anybody out there, you don't need to be a member. Anybody can say, hey, I want this new capability in the OSDU data platform. I start up something with another company or my own, or with five other companies, and create this new capability, bring it to the OSDU forum. It will be tested out there, will be validated out there. And once it's okay, it will be made available to all members. So everybody will have access to that. Yeah, we call it our shared backlog. So we have a shared backlog for all these new developments. And the OSDU Forum drives the data standards. There's not one company, how big you are, who can drive the data standards, the data definition standards. What are the data types? How does it all interlink? And we bring it together. We really create an energy data platform. Yeah, whether any type of energy, whatever it is, we bring together data into a single data platform. So we're creating an open energy data platform out there. Thank you.
Thanks, Johan. And thank you for joining us as we shared how OSDU is reinventing the energy data platform. Please complete the session survey, and thank you again for your attention.